We want to jump in right away this morning, and I just want to encourage you to let the Word of God, as always, sink in and bless you. But we've been on this series, and the series is called Chasing the Lion, Chase the Lion. And I'm excited for this series. I'm excited for this year. I'm excited for what God is doing, because I really believe that this series, Chase the Lion, it's, to me, it's a call for more intimacy. It's a call for God to say, lions are scary, and do the opposite of what comes naturally. Don't run from the lion, chase the lion. And that's a call to more intimacy, a closer walk with God, a deeper understanding of who God is and what he wants from me. And he does want more. He wants more from me. He wants more from you. But God never takes from you without your willingness to give. He doesn't take from you unwilling. He takes when we give from a willing heart to serve him, to honor him, to know him more, to be more effective, to be more fruitful. That's what I want for this year. Can I get one amen? Amen. I want to be more fruitful this year. I don't want this year to look like last year. I want to grow in him. I want to not make the same mistakes I did last year. If there's flaws in me and faults in my personality, all of that, I want them to diminish this year. If there's things, good things that I do or that I've done, I want to do more of them this year. I want to know God more. I want to be more fruitful for the kingdom is what it boils down to. So we talked about from 2 Samuel about Benaiah, who's this warrior. And this warrior, is the scripture talks about, that he went in and he killed a lion and this Egyptian warrior, this giant, apparently Egyptian warrior. And he fought two guys at once. And this is straight, great warrior. And we talked about him using the gifts that he had to honor God. And he was a Hebrew, obviously. And we had a little treat last week, 2 weeks ago, actually. And the little treat was that we were witness to a vow renewal here 2 weeks ago. If you missed it, it was very sweet. And what I did is I compared it to our relationship to the Lord. Because in the same way that it's healthy and it's good for a marriage relationship to constantly remain fresh. How many of you in here have been married longer than... How many of you in here have been married a year or less? Anybody in here like that? A year or less? Okay. How about 2 years? 3, 4? How about 5 years? I see that again. Okay. Let's go the other way. How many of you in here have been married more than 15 years? It's a lot. How about more than 20 years? Okay. Still a lot. 25 years. How many of you in here have been married 30 years or better? Lester's on, you're going to get tired. You're just going to get tired. 35 years or more. Oh, nice. I thought I'd lost a couple. I'm done. Whether I'm married or not, I'm done. 40. How about 40 years or more? Really? Wow. How about married 45 years or longer? Okay. How about 50 years? I thought I was going to land on Lester, but I was getting nervous there for a minute. Amen. How long? 57 years. That's like a whole lifetime of a person. Amen. That's a blessing. That's huge. Well, I got news for you. If you want a marriage relationship to be healthy and happy and thriving, now we have our ups and downs for sure, but if you want it to be healthy, from time to time, even regularly, consistently, you're going to make sure that that relationship is healthy, that there is the right amount of communication, that there's the right amount of intimacies. Otherwise, you'll end up with a roommate. And that's not what we sign on for when we get married. Amen? I don't want to discourage anybody here today. Maybe you're having some issues in your marriage. Well, hopefully by the end, you'll be encouraged. Amen? It's the same thing with the Lord. He has a relationship with us. He wants to communicate with us. He wants it to be fresh. And there are times where we need to sit back and we need to renew our vows with the Lord himself. Amen. And that ought to happen regularly. Amen? So this week we wanted to talk about seizing opportunities and facing fears. Seizing opportunities and facing fears. And as we work through Chase the Lion, I'm confident that that God is speaking to us. I don't know exactly what he's speaking to you. I know what he's speaking to me, and he does. He wants more of me. He wants more from me. Both, and I'm not talking about as a pastor. I'm not talking about as a minister. I'm talking about God wants more from me. As a child of God, God wants more from me. He wants more time with me. He wants more of my focus. He wants more of my attention, more of my love. It's what he wants from me. He wants me to be fruitful and to serve him in a different, better, deeper way. Amen? And I'm good with that. I'm good with that because it's what I want as well. And so we're going to walk this year, I hope, a little more confidently, a little more closely. And some of us here this morning, you said, well, I've been walking with the Lord a long time. Well, then I'd say this, we're going to walk with the Lord more closely, more confidently, but humbly as well. Humbly as well, because there's a tendency when we've spent a lot of time in the Lord to say, I got this. And we never got this, ever. We never will got this until Jesus comes back and we're with him, right? So we do want more this year for our own relationship, but we do so humbly, mildly, meekly, with grace. Pride has no place in my walk with the Lord, none. And so it reminds me of a little story, and the story goes like this. There's this big old lion in the forest, and he goes to a rabbit, and he kind of growls at him, and he says, who's the king of the forest? And of course, you know, the rabbit says, you are. You're the king of the jungle. And so the lion says, that's right. And he keeps going, and he goes to a big deer with huge antlers. And now the lion's a little trepidatious, because those are some big antlers. Who's the king of the jungle? And the deer's this huge buck with antlers and all that. And you are. So now he's feeling a little more confident, and he does the same thing with a crocodile, and he does the same thing with a great ape, and he does it with these powerful animals, and he's feeling pretty good right now. He's feeling quite prideful, in fact. So he even asks this ferocious tiger, who's the same size as he is, who's the king of the jungle? And he's waiting to see what'll happen. And the tiger says, you are. And so he leaves, and now he's just cocky and arrogant and prideful. And he's done this, and he realizes, I'm it. I'm the man, or the cat, or whatever. Get it, right? So finally he goes to an elephant, a bull elephant. Says, who's the king of the jungle? So the bull elephant picks him up by the mane, slams him on the ground, throws him into a tree, slams him down on the ground again, and stomps on him a little bit, and walks off slowly without even like losing a breath. And so the lion, of course, responds, you know, you didn't have to resort to violence. We could have simply discussed this. Listen to me, the point of this is this. The point is, if you let pride sneak in, if you think that the time you've spent in the Lord in any way grants you rights or privileges beyond anybody else, we are mistaken. Amen. What time in the Lord does, what spending time in the Word and in prayer and my years of serving and honoring God, what it does to me is not make me more prideful, it makes me more humble. Because I understand more fully how little we deserve. And so we do want more of the Lord, and we do want to grow, and we do want more intimacy, but we want to do so in a way that speaks of grace and of humility and of meekness to the people around us. Amen? Let me jump into some scripture. This is the one we read. This is my main text. 2 Samuel 23, Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, a valiant fighter, performs these great exploits, right? He struck down Moab's two mightiest warriors. He also went down into a pit on a snowy day and killed a lion. Verse 21, and he struck down a huge Egyptian. Although the Egyptian had a spear in his hand, Benaiah went against him with a club. He snatched the spear from the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own spear. That was probably the best UFC fight in history. I wish I'd seen it. But you know what? What it means is, did Benaiah go in there with no fear at all? Some of you don't even know what that is. That's okay. Don't worry about it. Doesn't matter. The UFC fight is just a style of fighting, martial arts. It's no rule. Basically, it's no rules fighting where two guys get in the ring and pound each other to the smithereens. And, you know, I guess they get paid for it, that sort of thing. So do you think that he wasn't afraid, Benaiah? Well, he was. He was afraid. But he didn't act on that fear. He acted in the confidence that he was a Hebrew. He was a man from a people. For whatever reason, I couldn't think of the American word. I kept saying Bobo, and that's not English. I'm sorry. He's from a people, a tribe, a nation that belonged to the Lord. And he knew that. And so I think that he acted in that. It's not that he had no fear. It's that he knew where to put it. And it was very interesting to me that God spoke today that when we are afraid, we walk into him. We walk into the Lord. That's where it's safe. That's where it's safe. So, amen. Let's get started. My first point this morning is seizing the opportunity. So, seizing the opportunity. There's a story of a little country boy in the 50s. And the young man's name is Sammy. And he wanted to run a diner and serve Jesus. That's all he really wanted to do. And here's this young man. He goes into the military. He comes out and he decides he's going to run this diner. And he starts doing his thing. And all he knows about running a diner is how to be godly and how to be generous. So, that's what he does. He loves the Lord. He's godly and he's generous with his family, with his employees, with the customers that come in. It's what he does. So God blesses him for that. And God blesses him with a couple opportunities. And every time an opportunity would open up, he'd seize it. He'd ask God, and he'd pray, and God would give him that opportunity. Today, Sammy's with Jesus, but his son continues to run what's become a 1.6 billion. I said billion. It's a lot of zeros. A billion-dollar empire. His son runs it today. You may have heard of it. It's a teeny little place called Chick-fil-A. Right? I really like their chicken sandwiches. Listen, you can say what you want about the way people see things and perspectives, but you're talking about a man or a woman who loves the Lord, who simply understands what it means to take an opportunity that God presents. Say, God, is this a bad idea or is this a good idea? And when God said, this is a good idea, then you seize that opportunity whether you're afraid or not. And that's what he did. It's kind of a simple story, right? But imagine the influence. Imagine the fruitfulness. Imagine what that little industry, what that business has meant. I like their chicken sandwiches, but if you know anything about the business, if you know anything about their company, they are very fruitful. They're very effective and they have a lot of good influence. And that wasn't given to them by people that like chicken. It was given to them because God saw this little young man and all he wanted to do was evidently make chicken and serve Christ and be generous and kind to people. It's a big deal. What was it? It's about seizing the opportunity. That's what this is about today. So his name is Samuel Truett Cathy. And I don't think for a moment that he realized the kind of authority, the kind of influence God was going to give him if he just seized that opportunity and was obedient in the way that he did it. That's kind of a story for all of us, I think. So my second point is the etymology of opportunity. The etymology of opportunity. And all etymology is a long word for the study of a word. The study of a word and its history and what it means and all that. And so the word opportunity itself is this. Opportunity is simply a set of circumstances that makes it possible for you and I to do something. That's an opportunity. A set of circumstances that make it possible to do something, right? There's this tiny little verse in Colossians chapter 4, verse 5. I know that you've heard it, but it doesn't get a lot of publicity. Colossians 4, 5 says, be wise in the way that you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Make the most of every opportunity. So the question for each of us is, do we see the circumstances in our day-to-day? When you wake up in the morning, by the time you go to bed at night, did we notice any circumstances in my day that says, this is an opportunity God gave me? Because if I'm not seeing them, it doesn't mean they're not there. It means I'm not looking. You understand what I'm saying? And so we want to move on. This past Wednesday, we spoke about one of the main tasks of a believer in this past Wednesday's Bible study. One of the main tasks of a Christian, of somebody who follows the Lord, is to encourage other people. Is to open your mouth and be positive with people and speak life and hope and kindness to the people around you. We're called to do that. There's a number of verses that tell me, encourage one another. Lift each other up. Lift each other up. Pastor, come on. That's not my personality. What am I, a Hallmark card? Am I my brother's keeper? Yes. Yes, you are to all of that. And now you say, but it's not really who I am. And I shared this Wednesday. It's not me either. It's not my personality to say, you look lovely today, honey. But guess what? If I want my wife to be happy, I better learn how to say, you look lovely today, honey, and I better mean it, right? So, and there's nothing wrong with me saying to myself, God, that's not part of my personality. It's not, well, I'm not warm and fluffy. I don't do fuzzy. And yet, I say to myself, your word tells me to be encouraging, so I'm going to do it. I'm going to make sure that I am lifting my brothers up and saying things to my sisters and being somebody that brings encouragement, not negativity, but good things, right? And in the process of doing those things, that's seizing an opportunity. When I have a chance to do that and say, you know what? I know you're tired, but I really want to encourage you, man. I'm praying for you. I know maybe you're not feeling well. You could do this with coworkers. You could do this with family. You could do this with a neighbor. You could do this with the guy that stole your rake and never gave it back. And listen, I know you stole my rake, but you know, have a good day. If there's anything I can do to help you. Be encouraging. Be positive with each other. It's something God's told us to do. And those are opportunities, but you've got to look for them to see them. You've got to look for them to see them. See, we want opportunities. We do. This is all making us feel pretty good. Yeah. Yes, seize the opportunity. Got it. Carpe diem. Seize the day, all of that, right? Or carpe chicken if you're Sammy or whatever. Listen, the point is this. We want our opportunity sliced up, medium rare, on a silver platter and handed to us. But that's not the way God gives us opportunity. God gives us opportunity when I step out and say, you know what? God, open my eyes. open my eyes. Who needs to hear me say something today? Who should I call? What can I do? How can I act in such a way that it's going to bless someone and honor you at the same time? That's an opportunity. Start taking those and he'll give you more. Amen. Making the most of every opportunity with eyes wide open, walking throughout my day. Never before in history, and I say this fully confident, never before in history has the world needed Christians to get up and be salt and light. Never before in history as much as right now. As right now, because there are so many, even Christians, who are confused. And they don't realize that black is black and white is white. Everything is gray because the world and the media and even their teachers in school sometimes, not all of them, but even the education system has taught them, hey, everything is okay. Everything is gray. There's nothing really wrong. There's nothing really right. You do whatever floats your boat and you're going to be okay. And its buzzword is tolerance. They're tolerant of everything except us. The world is tolerant of everyone except someone who says, listen, God loves you, but he says there's a right way and there's a wrong way. And if you do it the wrong way, he can't bless you. But if you do it the right way, he will. All of a sudden, we're not tolerant. For that, we're not tolerant. Julian is calling me on my iPad. Hey, thanks, buddy. I just preach it this time every Sunday. That's hilarious. Please pray for my family. Please pray that they survive after I get home. They're actually not here. Julian's not feeling well. Oh, I love that kid. More and more each day, really. Moving right along, never before in history has God needed us to be busy. Never before has God more needed his kids to be his kids. To stop beating around the bush and to be clear and vocal about what's right and what's wrong, but not in a way that beats people up. That's not what I'm called to do. What am I called to do? Look for the opportunity to encourage them. Look for the opportunity to build them up, to speak life, to speak love, to speak those things that are godly. Never before has this roaring lion, right? That's the way the devil's depicted in the word, as a lion. Roaring, looking to just mess people up. And never before has the devil been so busy keeping us distracted from our purpose. We get strangled. He keeps us distracted. We're distracted with pride, traditions, just have us all messed up. We're not doing what God called us to do. We're distracted. We're all tangled up. We're struggling with addictions, things Christians should not be struggling with. We're struggling with addictions and hang-ups and busyness and just, we're so busy, and that's a sin, folks. I said it before, I'll say it again. Hang-ups, and we're just flat out, we're so tired because of everything else that we do that we're missing all the moments God is giving us. We're missing them. And what this is is not some kind of scathing complaint about all Christians everywhere. What it is an encouragement to say, let's pay attention. Let's pay attention. Seize the opportunity. Seize the opportunity to speak life. Well, this is the time. This is the time. Which leads me to point number three. For such a time as this. For such a time as this. Listen, I am convinced that God brings the right people across my path at the right time. There have been times, maybe you've experienced something like this. There have been times where I'll meet someone. Maybe I'll get a phone number or whatever. And yes, I'm going to call them. And I have every intention of calling them. But for some reason, it doesn't happen. We don't connect. It doesn't happen. And it's not because I didn't want to. But it's just somehow we just, you know, two ships passing and that was the end of it. And it didn't happen. And you know what I've learned? I've learned that God sometimes does that on purpose. That it just wasn't meant either for that time or for that person. But what that means is that the opposite is true as well. What do you mean? What I mean is that there are people that God will cross my path and we'll talk and we'll exchange pleasantries or whatever, a phone number, and I realize this is a God thing. This is meant to be. This is the right time and this is the right place for me to understand that this is an opportunity. Whatever that may be, in a million different ways. In a million different ways. But sometimes it feels like this to me. Sometimes it feels like there's an opportunity. And I'm saying, oh no, this is the wrong time and the wrong place, and I'm just not able right now. And God is saying, you're missing it. You're missing it. It may look like the wrong time and place to you, but it's not. It's not. It's an opportunity. This happens in Esther. If you look in Esther chapter 4, verses 13 to 16. Now Esther is the wife. She's Hebrew, and she's the wife of King Xerxes, who's a Babylonian king. Persian king, I'm sorry. And so here she is, and her people, the Hebrews, are under condemnation, and they're not having the greatest time right now. They're in captivity, and her uncle Mordecai is trying to tell Esther, hey, Esther, you're married to the king. You've got to do us a favor. You've got to get this guy's ear. You've got to talk to him for us. You've got to talk to him for your people. And so here's what she responds. She doesn't want to because she's scared. She's afraid. She's afraid to talk to the king. And so she sends back this answer, and here's where we pick it up. Chapter 4, verse 13 in the book of Esther says this. He sent back this answer. So she's told him, listen, I don't want to do this. This is a bad idea. It's a bad idea. You don't just go pop in on King Xerxes and tell him what you're thinking. And so he sent back this answer to her. Do not think that because you're in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. Verse 14. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. What? Esther says, I'm scared. He says, listen, if you don't help his people, if you don't help your own people, the Hebrews, God's going to rescue them. He's going to use somebody else. Don't think you're off the hook. He'll use somebody else to help them. If you won't get busy, God will use somebody else. But you miss the blessing. You miss the opportunity. You continue in the struggle. Let me move on. Verse 15. No, actually, back it up to where we were. Arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come. This is still Uncle Morty talking. And who knows that you, Esther, have come to your royal position for such a time as this. Verse 15. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my attendants will fast as you do. Why? Because prayer will turn a 500-pound roaring lion into an opportunity. She's afraid. Legitimately so. Legitimately so. Somebody comes to you and says, go say the right thing, but they might kill you. We don't even understand that kind of fear here in Hamilton. But there are places all over the world they do. Christians serving Christ. This is very real. This is not a Bible story from ancient times that doesn't have any reflection on who God's children are today. There are God's children today being killed for honoring Christ, happening right now. We need to pray. But so here's what she continues to say. After you fasted, after we fasted, when this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. She says, I'm going to pray, I'm going to fast. You get all the Jews to pray and fast too. And in the end, I'm going to go talk to the king. And if he kills me, so be it. If he kills me, so be it. Bear in mind, just so to be clear, in Persia, you approach the king. If he hadn't called for you, it was punishable by death. You walk into the room unless he raised his scepter and allowed you to live. Just going to see the king could get you killed, right? If you read the story, you'll see that King Xerxes had actually already killed one wife for not coming when he called her, right? So Esther could have very easily thought, and probably did initially, no, he just killed his other wife, right? She didn't make him a sandwich. That's not for me. This is a bad time. Wrong place, wrong time. But it's not. God was giving her an opportunity. And she had to realize that. And she realizes the position. This is important. Listen to this. She realizes the position that God had given her was the right place and the right time. If you miss everything else, remember this. What is your position in Christ? Listen to me. Do not believe the lie that you've received from 100 different places. Oh, Pastor, you don't even know. You're talking about position in Christ. You don't understand. I'm really struggling with some stuff right now. Listen, I've been hiding stuff from you. The church doesn't even know. Fine, then let's talk about it. Let's get that sin out in the open. We'll deal with it. We'll talk about it. But that doesn't take away your position.
Amen.
Do you understand who you are? Struggles? Yes. But do you get who you are in Christ? Do we understand what your value is to God, to the Lord? You realize your value. Pastor, you're not listening. I'm no good to anyone. My marriage is in shambles or failing. I'm not doing the things I should. Listen to me. Listen to me. John chapter 1, verse 12. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, not to those who didn't have a flaw on them, not to those who were doing everything perfect, not for those who weren't struggling with this thing and that thing, to all who received his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Are you listening? I don't care what you struggle with. God's bigger than that. God's bigger than that. Your Father is the greatest. Your Father in heaven is the greatest counselor, healer, teacher, restorer of messed up lives in existence. Amen. Hear me very clearly. You can't break it bad enough that God can't fix it. It's not possible. It's not possible. But you still have to make the most of every opportunity. So here's the devil, the one that hates you more than anything, saying, why in the world are you going to encourage them when your life is the one? You're the one struggling with this. What are you going to say? What? How are you going to recite a Bible verse to that brother when you're the one struggling with pornography or lust or alcohol or drugs? Or how are you going to... Listen, when you walk in repentance, when you walk with Christ, I am not saying that this is license to sin. Hear me very carefully. This is not approval to do whatever and let it go. No, if there's something you're struggling with, we take that to someone. We go get help. We pray through and God heals and God restores. But in the meantime, you are his child and nothing's going to take you out of that. Listen, I know people that struggle with things and their attitude is, I don't need God. I don't want God. And I'm struggling with things. But I also know people who say, listen, I'm struggling with things, but I need God. And I go to God 3 times a day to say, God, forgive me. Help me. Amen. You think he's like, no, because you're not perfect. He doesn't do that. You're his child. You belong to him. I'm not sure we always get that. 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin. That's Jesus. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Not flawless. We say the right thing and do the right thing all the time. No, not like that. God gave him who had no sin, our sin, so that when he sees me, all he sees is grace. All he sees is mercy. Do I have to deal with my junk? Yes. Do you have to deal with your baggage? Yes. But don't let that keep you from following God. Amen. Honoring God. You hear me? God can restore, fix, heal, help. And we should seek that. We should seek that. But at the same time, there's a difference between the guilt that the world gives you and the conviction that the Spirit gives you. Because the conviction that the Spirit gives you will draw you to him. The guilt that comes from the devil, the one that hates you from the world, will say, you have so many issues, you might as well stop trying. You might as well just be fake. Play the game. Go through the motions. This isn't really for you, this service. Just ignore it. And I'm saying that's hogwash, because God is saying, you, I know, you with the issues. You with the issues. You. Be an encourager. Serve me. Honor me. Look for opportunities. I know you've got the junk in your life. Deal with that too. But in the meantime, I'm a child of God. I belong to him. Are we getting this? I know it sounds very simple. The question is, do we live that way? Do we live this way? Do we live this way? It is not your perfection, but his mercy that makes you valuable. It is your position that makes you valuable, precious to him, not your perfection. He'll perfect you. You just stay. You just let him do it. You just stay in his presence. He'll fix things as we go, but you just stay humble. Stay near him. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Pastor, if I come talk to you, I'm going to be so embarrassed. That's fear that keeps you from that. That's fear that keeps you from getting help. That's fear that keeps you from being more fruitful, more useful. Listen, everyone in this room is in the same boat. At the same time, we struggle with different things, but everybody in this room is in the same boat. There's nobody in this room that can say, well, I'm a bigger sinner than anyone here, so I'm just too embarrassed to make a difference, to really come talk to one. Listen, you belong to him. You're his child. The greatest opportunities, this is my last point, I'm done. The greatest opportunities are when we overcome our fears. The greatest opportunities, many times, are when we overcome, when we get over ourselves, for lack of a better word. Whether it's pride, shame, so embarrassed, but I want to be fruitful. I'm afraid that they'll fire me if I say something. I do the wrong thing at the wrong time, my friends will make fun of me. Those are real things. And when we get over those things, that's when the biggest opportunities come. Listen, whether it's Benaiah facing a real, honest-to-goodness lion, or Esther facing King Xerxes who's going to kill her, these are lion chasers, these people. It's what we're talking about. This is the series that we're in, Chase the Lion. Do more, be more, be more fruitful. Honor God in a deeper way. Let's be more. And as I'm saying this year, let's do more for the Lord. Some of you are thinking, I have too much junk. And this is the sermon to tell you, I don't care what you have. Because God can heal and restore and fix those things. But what he wants is for you to get closer to him. You need to hear this. All around you, God has planted people and opportunities for you. All around you, God has planted specific people and opportunities for you to encourage, for you to speak life to. To show kindness, to show godliness. There are lions you're supposed to be chasing right now. But Pastor, these people know me. They know me. They know my flaws. Exactly. That's exactly right. You don't go to them in pride. You go to them in genuineness. Hey, look, I'm not perfect. I'm not perfect, but man, I have to tell you, I want to pray for you. Well, I have to tell you, you should come to church with me. Be real. Nobody needs fake Christians. Nobody needs me to be fake. Nobody needs me to be what I'm not. If I go to minister to someone and say, listen, you should do this because I've been serving the Lord for a long time and I have no flaws. First of all, it'd make me a giant liar. Excuse me? Wow, man. Hey, thanks for the vote of confidence, buddy. He guffawed at me. Did you hear that? Listen. People don't need fake. People don't need tradition. People don't need ritual. People don't need mystical. You know what people need? Genuineness. Honesty. They need you to be real with them. You don't need to be afraid of your own humanity. Don't be embarrassed. Don't be ashamed. I've said this before, but I need to say it again. There are women in here who think you're the only one going through what you're going through. In the meantime, lady, miss, sister, let me tell you something. You're probably in the 80% of the women who are going through a similar thing that you're going through. Oh, you don't have any idea, Pastor. It's pretty weird. I know, but you're all weird. Listen. I sit in my office and I talk to people all day, every day, all week long, and I think to myself, whew, that's a good one. Listening to somebody, and they think they're the only one struggling, and they're not. They're telling me, so I feel like saying, I got three people that you guys could compare notes. Listen, God's grace, God's mercy is to take us out of that funk, out of that place, till we understand, till we realize I belong to him. Yes, I'm flawed. I might have a struggle. I might have a flat-out addiction, but I'm going to go get help for it. I'm going to go talk to somebody. Someone's going to be praying with me about this. And in the meantime, I'm a child of God. So I'm going to keep my eyes open for opportunity, and I'm going to speak encouragement and life and love and godliness to all the people around me. And God will begin to minister in you when you do that. I'm not saying be fake. I'm saying be genuine. All right. 2 Timothy, I'll close with these verses. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So when I walk to God in the morning, at night, whenever I'm praying, whenever I have my time with God and I'm repenting, God, help me, forgive me. I really blew it. I'm really struggling with this, or help my heart. And I'm repenting before Him. When I'm doing that, He's working in me, and He's giving me a sound mind, and He's taking away my fear. James chapter 4, verse 7, here's what it says. Submit yourself then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Submit yourself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. The word flee, I think it's fugo. It's the term to run away. In Italian, it's fuggire. So I'm not sure exactly if I'm saying fugio or fugo, but it's P-H-U-E-G-O. The word flee, fuego, it looks like fuego, but it's not pronounced that way, right? In Italian, like I said, it's fuggire, to run away, to flee. Who's he talking to? Us? No. He's talking about the devil. He's talking about when I resist the devil in Christ's name, the devil literally is running away from you. Do we get that? I hope we do. Listen, let this series sink in. This is week two, which really three. It should have been last week. I kind of merged a little bit. Let this series sink in that God wants more from you. He wants you to chase your lion, not just, oh, Lord, help me. Why are we in self-defense mode? God is your father. No, my dad can beat up your dad. Never has anyone been able to say that more accurately. Benaiah chases a lion into a pit. Despite the snow, slippery ground, he catches it and he kills it. Let's pray. Hallelujah. God, I am so grateful. I am so grateful that you look through all of my junk, all of our baggage and all of the issues that we struggle with. I'm so grateful, Father, that when we come to you in humility and say, Father, forgive me. In Jesus' name, make me better tomorrow than today. I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful that you look at me with mercy and grace and compassion. God, show us what we need to do to track down our own lions and kill them. Surround us, oh God, with an opportunity this morning and tomorrow and next week when we're out of church and we're not thinking about what the pastor said. God, surround us with opportunities to speak life and healing, salvation. We will not operate in fear, oh God, but we will operate in your name, in confidence, oh God, in courage and strength, knowing that we have all the power that we need. All the support is through our salvation, through grace. And God, we want to walk humbly in repentance today. And we ask that you would just make all of this reverberate around in our heart. God, the words that we've heard, I pray that you would let the word of God just stir us up. That we would begin to go home, make calls, write lists, see people that we know we should speak to. God, I pray that you would take us out of ourselves. You have assigned to everyone in this room work to do. God, we don't want to stay behind closed doors of our shame, closed doors of our addictions, closed doors of our pride, closed doors of busyness and weariness. God, we pray that you'd allow us to be fruitful and more effective now, 2017, than ever before. We love you and we thank you in advance for blessing our endeavor in your name.
Hallelujah.
We pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.